because let's suppose that we have a new climate. Then based on those standards, we realize that we don't have any reference in that time. We want just to use those two. We're not getting it.
I'm not sure all essential.
You have the I'm saying you have the depends of the standard you can use to identify the spectrum of that sort of work. But you realize that by looking at the references, you can't get any features which can link you to a specific. Yeah. So I'm asking if that one can be a limitation of using those tools.
Can you give me an example? I'm not sure that I'm answering that question. Our example is about taxonomies.
Yeah.
And you're talking about having an identified specimen in culture. And what you're not sure of is whether or not the taxon is in fact valid. And you want to be able to find that out.
Yeah.
Right? You want to be able to incorporate that information back into the collection at the source. Right? Yeah. Now, in terms of the standard, do you see that there is some kind of problem in doing so, or is that not the question?
Yeah, if you in fact you get program to reach a certain level of vision for your specimens.
Right. So as I understand it then, the idea is whether or not the standard itself is providing an obstacle to sharing information or finding out information about what the taxon really should be in terms of valid current classifications. Now, the Darwin Corridor doesn't say what you should put in your let's just use a scientific name as an example. So the Darwin Corps doesn't say what the rules are for what goes into your scientific name in terms of content. It doesn't say which species are valid. It's not doing any kind of validation for you whatsoever. All it's saying is that from your database, what you want to try to do is provide a full scientific name with authorship and date, if known, or if possible, or if relevant, so that we get things like an order for the alphabet, or a family listing for the alphabet, or a genus, or whatever. In this case, we try to do the best that we can fully specifying the taxon to which a specimen is identified. Okay? So that comes directly out of the database. Now, what you would like is to know if that name is known or valid. So if you're able to publish the name in scientific name, and if there is this magical tool, it will look it up in a database of names and give you back a valid name, then you've done everything you needed to take advantage of that service. Publish a name to test. Turns out there is such a service, and we'll show how to use taxonomic services a little bit during the course of our data assessment and community data publishing. So, being able to publish it in its original form is the important thing. The rest is dependent on what tools people have built in the rest of the world. And there are some nice tools for taxonomy, there's some nice tools for automated georeferencing, nice tools for testing various kinds of data, such as dates to see if they're valid, coordinates to see if they're valid, and so on. And we'll show a bunch of those during this. So does that help? Does that answer your question? Yes? Another question?
How different is this standard from the rest of the standards we use everywhere in the world?
how different is this one from the rest of the standards used in the world? For example, there are millions of standards. The ones that cover the biodiversity domain are few, although there are overlaps between some standards and parts of the Darwin Core, specifically to do with geographic information. So the Darwin Core is different in that it has a has specified geographic information in the format in which it is desired. Darwin Core could well have reused one or other different existing standards, but at the time it was revised, it was sort of a mess in terms of what those standards might be. Now, it could be time for Darwin Core to go back and find out, yes, there is a best practice way to do latitudes and longitudes that's different from, or that uses the pre-existing standard, and get rid of the extra stuff that we did and say, okay, change, we're going to now use another standard. That has not happened yet. So comparisons do exist, there are overlaps, and going forward, we believe that the Darwin Core will adapt to try to define within its own domain only those things that are specific to this domain. One of the first things to go, I would expect, would be this geographic information to use a different standard that's in the domain. But there's stuff within Darwin Core, as you can see, that no one else is providing standards for. And that's the real home playing field for this biodiversity.
Can you give a more specific comparison, Darwin Core ABCD? And tell us a little bit about what ABCD is and what its future is.
I don't know if I can say anything about what its future is. ABCD and Darwin Core are both compatible biodiversity standards that cover almost entirely the same scope. As I tried to explain earlier, the ABCD includes within it a structural definition. It already tells you the relationship between an identification and a taxon, and the relationship between a physical object in the collection and an identification. So all the structures are built in. Basically, you could build a relational database using the ABCD as an underlying model if you so choose. But the difference is that it has, because it has that structure, it has an inflexible data model. It has, let's say, a point of view that can't change without changing the standard. And that point of view is focused on the object in the collection. What does that mean? It means it's very difficult to change a perspective to be event-based. No. The observation world, they go back to the same place over and over and over and see what's there. They do monitoring. So for them, it's not the individual species that they see, it's the primary record. It's the place and time that is repeated over and over again. In order to capture that model, it's a complete inversion of the way the world is described in the ABCD. So it means that there's already a constraint on the world view in the ABCD that does not exist with the Darwin Core. It also means that the Congress of the Darwin Core has not made a commitment to how to view the world. So you can see that there will be benefits and problems from both perspectives. You know, that helps. I have to kind of be generic because I don't have to describe exactly XML schemas and master schemas that I have to use. Okay?
I briefly lead into it and the next presentation.
Okay.
In a little detail as well.
There's a question to two
questions. How come we use the standard? Now my question, how can we use standard to identify a doubtful species? For example, go to the field and grow a new tree and collect certain resources, species that we need to come out of the field. We know the family, we know the genus, but if we don't, we know the species. So, how, in that case, how can we use that for the fact?
Can everyone hear the question very well? I'm sure you can. The question is, how can we use the standard to capture the idea that we actually don't know a species very well. That we know it to a certain extent, but after that it's not very well identified. I'll give you a little tour of a few of the terms of Darwin. The thing is that in your specific cases, let's make it concrete, we know the genus, but it's new, it's interesting, it's probably a new species. And so we can't give it a specific epithet. So what do we do with the standard? What we do is we fill in everything that we do know. We know the kingdom, the phylum, the class, the order, the family, and the genus. After that, we don't know a specific epithet. We leave that blank. Right? We have no business filling that in. Now, we could fill it in with some designation saying this is new, something like SPA no B. But that has no meaning to anyone because it's not published anywhere. It's not actually a scientific name yet. So we have a place to put that. And the place to put that is the identification qualifier. So if I open that up and look at it, it is the place where we can say that our taxon appears to be something. It's tending towards something, or it's new. So examples here are CF and AFF. You could also put in there things like the, let's go see if the color set has anything further to say about it. It appears that it does not have anything really to say about it. So this is something, an area where community discussion could result in more useful documentation here about what to do in that case. The idea, though, is that it really isn't a scientific name, and yet Darwin Corps has a place to capture information that it is new, it's spinove, or that it's tending towards something that you haven't actually figured. And there was another question for the end.
What is the criteria to say something that is new or not new?
What are the criteria to say the data are clean or not? I would change the question a little bit. There is no answer that would satisfy everyone to say these data are clean and dry. I would say that the question is, to what extent can the information be used by going through a process of cleaning? In other words, how can we make it more fit for use, or how can we make it more easily usable? And that's going to vary term by term, and it's going to vary discipline by discipline, and it's going to have some community discussion around it. But in general, cleaner data are those that help us to discover and to communicate. So there's another concept to bring into play here is, in addition to data cleanliness, it would be data completeness. So a simple example for that would be this date. Let's take the entomological date.
There's two numbers, two letters, and then four numbers. Okay? So that's a verbatim data off of the tag. And it's perfectly clean. It's exactly right. It's the fourth month, 17th day of the year 1971. On the tag. It's clean. But most of us can't use that. There are no date parsers that know what that means. It's a standard only within entomology. So we want to share, we want to do species interaction. We want to know what insects co-occur with what plants. And in the plant community, they're not using this connotation, not using this convention. So cleaner or more useful data would be to turn that entomological format of the verbatim date into a date time that everybody can understand. So we want to turn it into this ISO date that is described in the verbatim date. Does that make sense? We want to make it more useful, more accessible to a broader community than the one that we find ourselves in. The big idea around Darwin Coalition is to share more broadly. More broadly than we think about every day. So one of the things that we try to instill in people when they're publishing their data is to try to provide information about every single Darwin core field that we can. Every one that makes sense to do it. Because the more you provide, the more likely it's going to be useful to someone.
Yeah, in your example, you've gone into the field, you've identified a species,